Father God, we thank you tonight for this opportunity and privilege to come and to study the Word of God. We thank you for the Spirit of God being here to give us insight and revelation into our lives. We thank you, Father, that even as we look at the topic of moving forward, we thank you, Father God, for the Spirit of God allowing us and showing us areas of our life where we can, that may hinder us from moving forward as you see fit. And so we just want to praise you tonight and give you glory. We give you honor. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
All right, so we have been sharing with you on moving forward, and we said a faith connection. Praise God, it requires faith to move forward in the things of God. You know, you cannot move forward just on goodwill or wishful thinking, but you really have to believe what God has spoken to you. And so we're going to talk about moving forward with praise. And so this is the something the Lord gave me while I was at work the other day, and this is the thing he kind of shared with me. And what I need to be saying over my life, and really what we all should be saying over our lives, and that is, I will not despise where I am on my journey to where I will be. Because a lot of people live like that. They put their happiness over into the future of when I get, you know, but it's important. The Bible says, despise not the days of small beginnings. And so many times we think, see, we have a tendency to think that small means it's not anointed. Small means it's not God, simply because something is small. And so, but that really isn't the case. Many times God will always start out with something small to do something great. One of the small things that we do in our life is learning how to praise him. And I say this, you know, just even on when it comes to worshiping God and praising God in the services, that has to come out of a person's heart. You know, a song really can't do it, not genuine praise. A song can strike emotions, but that doesn't necessarily mean you're really tapping into the spirit of praise, whereby you're exalting him. Many times in praise, what we're doing, we're exalting our feelings, but we're really not exalting him. That's why I believe you have to always prompt people to worship God and praise God, because I think a part of that is they really don't have a lifestyle of praise. When you have a lifestyle of praise, you don't need a song. Amen. All you need to do is just remember. Remember what he's done for you. That's true. Where he's brought you from. You know, you know, just to be able to be in the midst of your workday saying, Lord, thank you. Man, I remember when. I remember when I used to have a bad attitude about my job. But thank you, Lord, for always helping me to maintain a positive attitude. And so, you know, that's praiseworthy, amen, because we know that's not by my strength. That's by his grace working in me and by the power of the Holy Spirit. So, remember this saying, I will not despise where I am on my journey to where I will be. Listen, our praise life must move beyond mental assent into revelation of God's word concerning our lives. Mental assent simply says, yeah, I know what the word says. They can quote it to you, but they won't live it. That's just mental assent. Revelation of the word is the word you actually live out on a daily basis, consistently. You don't just do it for a week, then miss, do it for a week, then miss. You consistently do this over years. That's revelation. Most people don't have revelation. Some people are trying to work up a revelation in the hitting and missing. But when it becomes a revelation, you just can't do without it. You know, just like revelation of breathing. If you don't breathe, you die. So guess what? You breathe. All right? It's a revelation. You ain't have to really think about it. You just do it. Because you can't stop and hold your breath, right? But you choose to keep breathing. Mm-hmm. Amen. And so, you know, and so it's that way with the Word of God. You just choose to keep doing it. It don't matter what it looks like. You just keep on breathing in and out the Word. Keep walking in. But our praise life must move beyond that mental ascent into revelation of God's Word concerning our life. In other words, in order for that thing to be revelation, we got to be walking in something consistently over time. Again, I'm talking about years. If you look in the Bible, God never promoted anybody to king or priest, right, until there was years of, not just years of hit and miss, but years of consistency before God ever promoted them. I mean, God would, but here's the thing, my God, in his grace, he would always come to where you were and tell you what he wanted to do. Then he gave you years to prepare yourself before he ever moved you into the position. Come on, amen. And we got to know, remember I said this is a journey. It's not like, this ain't like instant oatmeal. You know, amen. You know, 90-second rice. You know, it's more than that. This is a lifestyle that God is trying to develop our character. And again, a part of our character is seen in our ability to pray.
Amen.
It really is. Your character, a person's character speaks a lot to me when it comes to how they deal with the circumstances of life. And I'm not saying that we don't have times when pressure hits us. I'm not saying we don't have times when we cry. But even in the tears, there's something that still will come off our lips and say, but nonetheless, I'm going to still praise God.
I call the Hebrew boys a mentality.
Yeah, nonetheless. even if he throws in, nonetheless, we still ain't going to bow. And, you know, we can't bow. You know, just because feelings come don't mean we bow to them. Doesn't mean we give in to them just because they come. And I think that, again, that's a part of developing the character of God in our life, that when the Bible says, in everything give thanks. Without a praise life, you won't see how to do that. Without a revelation of what God has done and a memory of where he has brought you from, the grace that he has shown you, you won't have a praise life. You won't have a consistent praise life. It'll be up and down. And then he says, I'm not talking about praise being emotional.
All right.
Because I think we so make it melodramatic that people think they can't praise because they can't praise like that. But praise is what birth praise is, and praise comes out of it is exalting God. That's what praise means. It means to exalt. And so when you're facing a situation through tears, you may be facing a really hard situation, but you can still say, well, God, I remember how you made me a promise back then. And I know you can't lie. I know you are faithful, and I'm not giving up. I'm not throwing in the towel. I'm going to keep moving. I'm going to keep trusting you. I'm going to keep believing you because I believe what you promised me. Listen, that's praise. When you put what he says above every circumstance around you, that's praise. It's exalting him. It's saying, I'm going to exalt you above how I feel. Even though I might be in the thralls of what I feel, I will not exalt what I feel to the point where what I feel will control what I say. That makes sense. So this is, if you are consistently despising where you are, it is an illusion that you are moving forward. And many people are despise where they are. They do. They despise. They don't say, they smile, but they despise where they are. They hate where they are. They don't know how to celebrate right where they are. And you moving, and that person moving forward, is an illusion. They're not moving forward until you can conquer that error, whereby you can in all things give God thanks. It's an illusion. It's like the person that buys the big house and has the mansion and the nice big yard and the pool in the backyard, and everybody looks at it and says, wow, that is successful. He's got a job that's paying, I know, $500,000 a year. Man, that's a successful man. But you don't know that even though he's got all that, his debt is greater than what he has. But we call it a success. Or what about having all that but have no character? What if he had all that but he wasn't faithful to his wife, didn't really love his kids? You see what I'm saying? There's a lot more. We have a tendency to look at things in a very warped perception that really isn't the heart of God. So if you're consistently despising where you are, it is an illusion that you're moving forward. You're not moving forward if you consistently. And I'm not saying you're going to have moments where you're like, man, I don't like being in this situation. You're going to have a moment. But the moment isn't more than your praise life. But you have moments where we don't like certain things that happen in our lives.
Of course.
You know, we all do. But is that the norm? Or is that the exception to the rule in terms of how you live your life every day? It should be an exception to the rule, because what should happen, even in those times when things, you're like, oh man, but if you have a revelation of God, you will reel all that back in and say, but nonetheless, Lord, I remember how faithful you are to me, and your grace and your love will get me through this, so I'm going to stick with you. I'll not turn to the left or to the right. I'm going to trust in you with all my heart. Amen. So look at Psalms 34, verse 1. This is in your notes. I tried to get this over because I had a lot to go through and I didn't want to have to stop and flip pages. So. But Psalm 34:1 says this. By David, when he pretended to be insane in the presence of Abimelech, Abimelech threw him out, so David left. He says, I will thank the Lord at all times. My mouth will always praise him. My soul will boast about the Lord. Those who are oppressed will hear it and rejoice. Praise the Lord's greatness with me. Let us highly honor his name together. I went to the Lord for help. He answered me and rescued me from all my fears. See, but now why could he say that about praising God at all times? Now, we know David didn't praise God at all times. There were times when he, like, Lord, why is this happening to me? Why you let this occur? But that wasn't the norm of David's life. David was known for his worship. I mean, David would worship on the harp even when he was a little boy, and that spirit that was upon Saul would depart. So he had a heart that was towards God way back when. And I believe what we see are the speed bumps of his life where he has moments where he's running from hilltop to hilltop to valley, hiding out in caves, you know, everybody's against him, and he's wondering, like, why am I even going through all this? But David always came back with the Psalms of praise. See, regardless of what you go through, what do you go back to? Where do you end up? See, a problem may come, the storm may come in your life, and it hits you, and it blows you, and gets you wet, and you're cold, and you're shivering. But it's not the beginning of it that's important. What's the ending that you come to in the midst of that storm? Do you come to the conclusion that I will still praise the Lord? I will still bless the Lord because he's worthy to be praised.
So you came back to the first love.
Yeah, you go back to the first. But stuff, like, remember I told you something, life will hit you, man. Life will, bam, catch you off guard sometimes. And it will shock you. But you know, it's like a boxer, when he gets hit by that punch he doesn't see. And it knocks him down. That's what the Bible says, a righteous man falls seven times. But his heart is revealed in the fact that he always gets up. And your heart is revealed when towards your attitude towards God, when things hit you, but you get back up. You don't stay down in the mully grubs, like Pastor Cap said, the mully grubs. You don't just lay there and whimper about where you are. You don't cry about, I didn't see that pump. Well, it's too late now. It's already hit you. I was going to get up and shake it off and keep moving forward. Amen? Amen. All right. So this is. So he says here, I will thank the Lord at all times. Now, let's talk about that word thank for a minute. Why would you thank somebody?
Because you appreciate what they've done.
Come on, you appreciate what they've done. Amen. So thank you always comes out of recognizing that someone has done something for you. So how you go praise if you don't ever recognize what God has really done for you? If you spend most of your time talking about the negatives of life.
Say that.
Rather than seeing the positive of what he has done. You know, you might be hurting, but at least you're not dead.
Amen.
You might not have as much as you want, but thank God you still have something.
Amen.
You might not be eating filet mignon, but thank God you're not hungry because you got bologna.
Amen.
You see what I'm saying? You got something to be thankful for. Because there are some people that will love your bologna.
Say that.
Hey, come on, amen. And take it and think it's manna from heaven.
Say that.
And so, you know, so if you're going to be a thankful person, and you're going to be thankful towards the Lord, you have to have a book of remembrance of the things he has done for you. Because I'm telling you, when life hits you, you're going to forget those things, and you'll be caught up in the thralls of what you're dealing with. But it's good to be able to go back and read and remember the things that God has done for you, the things that he has promised you, the things that he has said to you. I tell you, the thing that always gets me moving and keeps me moving in terms of serving God, is this one thing he told me. He said, Donald, I called you to be a seed planter. He said, and you will not see a lot of the results of the things you do, but have confidence in the seed sown. So that keeps me going, because when I don't see nothing, I said, no, but hold up. I don't have to see nothing, because you already told me that I wouldn't see much. But I'm to have confidence in the word of God that I'm giving to people.
Amen.
And who knows how far this word goes? Mm-hmm. Who knows how many people take it and it affects their life and they share it with somebody else and they share it with somebody else and they share it. Before you know, that one word God gave you has gone around the world, even though you may never know it.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Amen? So don't despise where you are. Quit dreaming about someone else's yard and live in your own.
Yeah.
Say that.
Thank God you got a yard to look at.
Mm-hmm.
Amen? Mm-hmm. That's how we have to live our lives. We have to look at where we are and what we've been presented with and give God praise and thanksgiving for that. Because he didn't have to give you that. Amen? And so we need to be thankful. He says, I will thank the Lord at what? All times. My mouth will always praise him. And what is he saying when he says, is he talking about singing hallelujah songs? No, he's talking about exalting what God has done. My mouth will talk about what you've done. My mouth will talk and celebrate where you brought me. My mouth will rehearse what you promised me. That's what he's really talking about, praising God. He's not talking about a song. We take praise and worship and just turn them into songs. That's not really what praise and worship is. Not under the New Testament, what we have through Jesus Christ.
Amen.
How many believe Jesus was a praiser?
He did nothing but praise.
But if it was a song, then why can we never read about him singing?
Did nothing but praise.
If worship was a slow song, then why don't we see Jesus singing slow song? Why doesn't the Bible put emphasis on that if that's what worship was? If worship was songs, then Jesus would have done a lot of it. Why? Because he is our example.
Mm-hmm.
And remember when the disciples was on the Mount of Transfiguration and they saw Moses and Elijah? And they said, let us make three tabernacles, one for Moses, one for Elijah, and one for Jesus. And the Bible said the cloud came down and when they lifted, all they saw was, and God said, this is my beloved son, hear ye him. Mm-hmm. In other words, you don't need Moses, you don't need Elijah, you got everything you need in him.
Amen.
Come on, amen. So Jesus became my example of what worship is. Remember Jesus talking to the woman at the well? And she said, you know, our fathers worship in this mountain. He said, you know not what you worship, but worship is of the Jews. He said, but God is a spirit. He said, but now is the time for the true worshipers of God to worship the Father in spirit and in truth. Okay, if he says true, the word true means genuine. Mm-hmm. Which means everything before Jesus wasn't genuine. Mm-hmm. It was a foreshadowing, but it wasn't the genuine. Mm-hmm. So what Jesus does, he gives us the example of what worship and praise is. And what worship and praise really is, it is seen by the life you live. Because you can sing a song of I love you all day long, but if your lifestyle don't reflect that in your actions and your decision making, that you don't love him. You can sing that song all day. And it means nothing. Because now why? Why is that so significant? Because you gotta understand that God gave you his spirit when you got born again. He gave us his spirit so that we were empowered, listen, to live above sin. So now, if we don't live above sin, it's not a power problem. It's a choice. But our obedience to God is what gives praise to his name. The Bible said we were created unto Christ unto good works. Right? The Bible said that men should see our good works and do what? Give glory to our Father who is in heaven. It's all about the fact that we were saved to show forth God's goodness.
Amen.
That's praising God. I mean, what would it be like for a man to stand in the sanctuary and raise his hands and sing, I love you, I love you, I love you, Lord, today, and sing all that and go out, cheat on his wife, beat his kids, won't go to work. Come on, amen. What, that don't mean nothing to God. What God is looking at now, you have been empowered, listen, to live like Jesus.
Mm.
So the songs, that's why people don't worship in services. Because their lifestyle don't reflect that. That's why you got a problem all the time. Now, sometimes people just don't know, they ain't been in that environment, I understand that. But when you've been taught, mm-hmm. and you still don't, mm-hmm. something's going on in your life. It shows that there's a disconnect. Listen, in your memory of what he has done for you. The Bible said they overcame the enemy by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony.
Mm-hmm.
What's a testimony? Mm-hmm. Something God has done, right?
Mm-hmm.
Anybody got a testimony?
Cricket?
Yeah, the cricket's gone. You gotta wait.
Cricket?
And you know, oh, God, think of something, and you think of something. You should have been thinking about it all along. And for, listen, I don't care if it's the same Old Testament you've been shared 25 times. You keep sharing it to God to something else. You know why? Because you sharing it is showing God that you're thankful. Don't ever think that your testimonies get old. They don't. They may get old to the people around you. They may get old to you sometimes. But they never get old to God. Because He likes to be glorified. He likes to be bragged on. Now this is one thing that strengthens our praise is knowing that we are following the Lord's instruction. Say it again. One thing that strengthens our praise is knowing that we are following the Lord's instruction. A lot of times people struggle with praising God in the sanctuary because their lifestyle kind of jacked up. But you know, obedience does strengthen your life. You know, when you're obedient, you have more confidence in God. But when you're disobedient, you don't have much confidence in God. Thus, it's going to affect your praise life. All right. So let's look at Gideon. Wow, my time is flying. Let's look at Gideon. Judges chapter 6. We'll start at verse number 11. And Gideon represents a man who had a lack of confidence. If you go back and read the whole story, if you have time, go back and read it. Gideon was not a man of confidence. He didn't have a lot of confidence in himself. And so let's read here and pick verse 11. It says, the messenger of the Lord came and sat under the oak tree in Ophrah that belonged to Joash from Abiezer's family. Joash's son Gideon was beating out wheat in a winepress that hid it from the Midianites. The messenger of the Lord appeared to Gideon and said, the Lord is with you, brave man. Gideon responded, excuse me, sir. But the Lord is with us. Why has all this happened to us? Now, isn't that what causes us to lose our praise? Mm-hmm. Why is this bad stuff happening? Why is this bad stuff? The bad stuff happens because life happens. Mm-hmm. But here's the thing. The bad things happening becomes an opportunity for you to praise God.
Amen.
Because in everything, do what? Give thanks. Not for it, but in the midst of it. Give thanks. Why? Because you believe that God will show up and do what He promised He would do. Mm-hmm. Amen. This is Gideon responded, excuse me, sir, but the Lord is with us. Why has all this happened to us? Where are all the miracles our ancestors have told us about? Didn't they say the Lord brought us out of Egypt? But now the Lord has abandoned us and has handed us over to Midian. The Lord turned to him and said, you will rescue Israel from Midian with the strength you have. I am sending you. Gideon said to him, excuse me, sir.
What you say?
He said, how can I rescue Israel? He said, look at my whole family. It's the weakest one in Manasseh. And me, I'm the least important member of my family. The Lord replied, I will be with you. You will defeat Midian as if it were only one man. But this dude didn't have no confidence in himself. None whatsoever. But here's what I learned from this. We don't need to have confidence in ourselves. We need to have confidence in the Lord.
Amen.
Because you having confidence just in you produces arrogance. But the thing that Gideon, he looked at his own shortcomings, his own weaknesses. And he determined that I'm the weakest among everybody in my family. I'm the least person you want to use to deliver these people. See, when somebody says, excuse me, sir, that's not a confident response. That is a response that says, oh, you got the wrong person. Who you brave? Who you talking to? You know, really? Not me. But you know what? God says, but if I can just find somebody who would just believe me and do what I say, this average, less than average man will defeat an army as though it was only one man. Why? Because when Gideon didn't realize that in his weakness, God's strength was made perfect.
Amen.
It's not about how equipped you are. It's not about, see, it always concerns me when people start putting their confidence in their things and their stuff and their position and their money, it always bothers me because I said, boy, because one bad incident, and when all that's gone, what you gonna do? What you gonna do? And you have to think about that. So I don't want to be confident in my job. I don't want to be confident in my plan. I want to be confident in my Father who is faithful, who empowers me to carry out His will. And since He empowers His will, then it is to my benefit to get in agreement with Him so that He can live His will through me. Mm-hmm. Praise God. Look at Judges chapter 7. This is Judges chapter 7, verse 16. This is getting, at first he started with like 3,000 men, and God said, that's too many people. That's too many people. See, sometimes we're confident in our whole lot of stuff. Mm-hmm. We're confident in what we have. We're confident in our education. We're confident in our position. We're mm-hmm. confident in our pension. We're confident in our 401k plan. We're confident in our smarts.
Numbers.
We're confident. Yeah, we're confident in who we know.
Mm-hmm. Quantity instead of
yeah. Thank you. We're confident in our quantity. And God told Gideon, "That's too much. Mm-hmm. I don't need 3,000 men.
Too many cooks.
too many cooks. I think he said, "Whoever's scared, go home." Mm-hmm. Half of them went home. Then he said, "Now take them down to the brook and see how they drink."
Mm-hmm. I'm surprised Gideon didn't go.
Exactly.
Can I go in? I'm going home with them.
When God got done, he got down to 300 men against the army of Midian. So look what Gideon did. And so let me say, God gave Gideon instruction. Gideon followed the instruction of God. So let's look at John chapter 7, verse 16. It says, Gideon divided the 300 men into three companies. He gave them each ram horns and jars with torches inside. He said to them, "Watch me and do what I do." Now you gotta understand, these 300 men following him, and he giving them instructions and just do what I do. Is that the battle plan? That didn't look like a smart battle plan.
They probably think it's one of those things you do, run, so we can.
Look at him. Look at him. Exactly. Look at him. He says, verse 7, he said to them, "Watch me and do what I do. When I come to the edge of the camp, do exactly as I do. When I and those with me blow our ram horns, then the rest of you around the camp do the same and shout for the Lord and for Gideon." And Gideon and his 100 men came to the edge of the camp. It was the beginning of the midnight watch, just as the change of the guards. They blew their ram horns and smashed the jars they were holding in their hands. The three companies also blew their ram horns and broke their jars. They held the torches in their left hand and the ram horn in their right hands so that they could blow them. They shouted, "A sword for the Lord and for Gideon." Now notice what they started doing. Mm-hmm. Praising. Mm-hmm. They started shouting. While each man kept his position around the camp, everyone in the Midian camp began to run away, screaming as they fled. Mm-hmm. They didn't know they were running from 300 men. The 300 men kept on blowing their ram horn. The Lord caused a whole... Now, listen. Don't miss this little statement here, because this is what we miss. We read it too fast. Mm-hmm. It says the 300 men kept on blowing their round horns, and the Lord caused the whole camp of Midian to fight among themselves. In other words, when they got obedient to God and began to praise God, guess what? Then the Lord came onto the scene. So it wasn't just the 300. It was when they followed the instructions that were given. Thank you, Jesus. When they followed the instructions that was given to them by following Gideon, who in his own confession was the least among everybody, mm-hmm. was a nobody. But they submitted themselves, to a nobody. Mm. And when they followed the instruction of the nobody, who had heard from somebody. Come on. Mm. And when they followed his instruction and did what he said, then the Lord began to work on their behalf.
Then he became somebody to everybody.
There you go. And then he became somebody to everybody because he had heard from the somebody. Praise God. Look what he said. He said, they fled as far as Beth Shittah, towards Zerera. And as far as the banks of the streams of Abel Meholah near Tabath. So they fled. from 300 men who had a, listen, who praised God, who followed God's plan and had a praise. Now, this is what I said. Your praise is strengthened by your obedience. If you are not an obedient person, you are not going to have a strong praise. Your praise is going to be real iffy because your lifestyle is real iffy. But when your lifestyle is one of obedience, boy, you can praise your hands, raise your hands and praise the Lord. Say, ooh, I thank you, Father God. You see, your obedience gives confidence to your praise. Amen. All right, so let's look at the walls of Jericho. The walls of Jericho represent physical and spiritual barriers. Each of us will have physical and spiritual barriers in our life that will keep us from trying to move forward. Mm-hmm. And look at Joshua chapter 6, verse 1. It says, Jericho was bolted and barred shut because the people were afraid of the Israelites. No one could enter or leave. The Lord said to Joshua, I'm about to hand Jericho, its king, and its warriors over to you. All the soldiers will march around the city once a day for 6 days. 7 priests will carry ram's horns ahead of the ark. But on the 7th day, you must march around the city 7 times while the priests blow their horns. When you hear a long blast on a horn, all the troops must shout very loudly. The wall around the city will collapse. Then the troops must charge straight ahead into the city. Mm. So they got, here's the thing. In order for me to have a strong praise life through my obedience, I can't be obedient until I first hear from God and do what he tells me. Mm. So then if an individual isn't spending time in the presence of God or any time in the Word of God, then how can they be obedient to somebody that they don't listen to? Thus, your praise life not going to be strengthened. That's why folks go to church on Sunday morning and praise like crazy and jump up and down the aisle and jump the pews and roll around the floors and leave out and still cussing everybody out. Because it's just a fleshly activity with no life-changing results. What strengthens our praise is our obedience. Look at Joshua 6:15. And remember this, God gave them instructions. Spend time in the presence of God to get instruction. Verse 15. On the 7th day, they got up at dawn. They marched around the city 7 times, the same way they had done it before. That was the only day they marched around it 7 times. When they went around the 7th time, the priests blew their ram's horns. Joshua said to the troops, shout! Because the Lord has given you the city. In other words, your shout is an indication that you believe what God said.
Amen.
And to the degree you believe will be the degree you shout. You won't have a confident shout if you don't really believe. Yay. Isn't that how some people praise though? Come on. Shout with the voice of triumph. That's how they shout. Got a problem? And I'm like, no, they just stop prodding people. They don't want, if they don't want to praise them, that's on them. Just take their blessing. They don't want it. Amen. I mean, seriously, just take that. They don't want it. Mm-hmm. All right, this is it. So, verse 20, Joshua 6:20. So the troops shouted very loudly. Now, they didn't just shout. They shouted very loudly when they heard the blast of the ram's horn and the walls collapsed. Mm-hmm. The troops charged straight ahead and captured the city. Now, see, they could have been complaining, walking around that wall. Why don't we walk around this wall? And we walk around this wall. Man, what's the point of this? And then you got the enemy on top of the wall laughing at you. Mm-hmm. And you walking around the wall. Just walking around the wall. Walking around the wall. Not saying nothing. Just walking around. You know how stupid that looks? Listen. If you really want victory in your life, get God's plan. And I guarantee you, the plan God gives you go look stupid to the world. Mm. It will go totally contrary to how you think the plan should go. God never gives sensible plans. You know why? Because he gives plans that it requires him to fulfill. If you can fulfill your plan, you don't need God. So they just walked around the wall. Didn't make no sense. Walking around the wall. 6 days, we walking around this wall. On the 7th day, we walk around this wall 7 times. Not making a sound. Not no one. Listen, I guarantee there wasn't any mumbling and grumbling. See, sometimes, listen, you cancel out what God tells you to do by your complaints about what he told you to do. even though you could be in the middle of doing it. You could be giving your tithe and complaining on the inside. In your heart, you could be complaining the whole time and counseling out everything you're doing.
Say that.
That makes sense. All right. So know that they follow God's instruction. They shouted with a very loud shout. They didn't go, yay. They really shouted. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you can get people to shout at church like they shout at a football game, my God.
Come on.
Man, hell would roll away. So they shouted, obey God. So listen, the physical and spiritual barriers were broken. This is when they broke out in praise. But the praise was birthed out of the fact that they had been obedient for 7 days. And before the 7 days, the day before that, they received instruction from God and followed his instruction. Thus, God spoke, they obeyed, then they shouted over what he said, and they got exactly what they said. He said he would do for them. And a lot of times we don't operate that way, do we? Mm-hmm. We operate very different from that. If God tells us to do something, we complain about it. Mm-hmm. We don't say it out loud, sometimes we just murmur in our hearts mm-hmm. about what he tells us to do. Mm-hmm. Complain. I hear people say this. I hear people say, I don't follow no man. I just follow Jesus. But that's a lie. A man made those rules out down the road. You follow those. A man made that stop sign that says stop. You stop. See, that's a cop-out. It's just a cop-out. People follow all kinds of rules. Red light, green light, they were made by men. You stop. Red light, you stop. Don't you? Green light, you go. School zone, you stop. I don't think God got school zones in heaven.
Ambulance, you move up to the side.
Exactly. All these things men tell us to do. But then when it comes to the things of God and men of God, oh, English, no men of God, he's just a man. He got faults just like I do. Oh, the same people out there that's doing all the other stuff, that they got, the person that made the street lights and operate and keep those work, they don't have faults either. But you follow that instruction without argument. In fact, you complain about other people who don't follow the rules.
Say that.
But when it comes to God and men of God, then we get all squirrely. Just saying. You're not doing too much with it. All right, this is the King Jehoshaphat. And the King Jehoshaphat represents seemingly overwhelming odds. You're going to have a situation in your life that's going to be seemingly overwhelming for you. It's going to seem like the odds are against you. Like there's no hope of winning. Great. Now you have an opportunity to get God involved. Mm-hmm. You know that song we used to sing, God specializes? Those things that seem impossible. Come on, God specializes. Right? Well, you need him to... Do you want to live an ordinary life or an extraordinary life?
Extraordinary.
If you're going to live an extraordinary life, you got to let go of your ordinary ways of doing things and follow God's instructions, because God's instructions don't make sense.
So come on.
And people don't want to, because people don't realize how much they really try to control their lives, and never ask God about what He wants to do. And many times it's very subtle ways that people do this. All right, look at King Jehoshaphat. 2 Chronicles chapter 20 verse 16. It says this. This is after King Jehoshaphat. Had the three armies come against him. The Bible says he set himself to seek the Lord. He called for a fast. All the people came together and said, hey, you know, what we go do? We cannot win against this army. The odds, the cards are stacked against us. The odds are not in our favor. What are we going to do? And so one of the young men there began to speak by the Spirit of God and told him, look, this battle is not yours, it's the Lord. Tomorrow you're going to go out against him and you're going to do this, and this. And look what he says in verse 20. Verse 16, he tells them chapter 20, verse 16 of 2 Chronicles. He says, tomorrow, go into battle against them. They will be coming up the Ziz Pass. You will find them at the end of the valley in front of the Jerul Desert. You won't fight this battle. Instead, take your position, stand still, and see the victory of the Lord for you, Judah and Jerusalem. Don't be frightened or terrified. Tomorrow, go out to face them. The Lord is with you. That's what you got to know. That's what you just, if you want a real surfer, you just got to know the Lord is with you.
Amen.
And if the Lord be for you, who can be against you? You just got to know that. And you know what? You just got to get a revelation of that.
Mm-hmm.
That it keeps you from complaining about stuff.
Mm-hmm.
People think complaining is an indication that they care.
Mm-hmm.
No, complaining don't mean you care. Complaining means you don't believe God. All right, verse 18. Jehoshaphat bowed down with his face touching the ground. Everyone from Judah and the people who lived in Jerusalem immediately bowed down in front of the Lord. The Levites, descendants of Kohath and Korah, stood up to praise the Lord God of Israel with a very loud song. They say this song with very loud song. Now, why do they do that?
Mm-hmm.
It is an indication they believe what God said. Whenever God speaks something you ought to do, and you go, oh, why, you don't believe it. Because listen, God never asked you to do anything without the intent of blessing you.
Amen.
If you don't obey God, you think God will be any less. If you don't obey God, do you truly believe God is going to be anything less than God just because you don't obey? No. So why does he need your obedience?
Come on.
So he can bless you.
That's right, for our benefit.
Yeah, for our benefit. Yeah. Look, you can live in disobedience for the rest of your life. Won't affect me. One, I will still be God.
Amen.
But when I give you instruction, it's always with the intent to bless you. I want to show you my goodness.
Mm-hmm.
But I can't show you my goodness in rebellion and disobedience. Look what he says here. Verse 20. The guy starts singing prayer. He heard the word. Listen, say, how many times you praise the Lord at church when you hear the word of God going forth? Sometimes you just get, did they ever get good and different? Whoo, glory. Hey, amen. Hallelujah. You ever just want to do that sometime?
Mm-hmm.
Why can't nobody ever do that?
Mm-hmm.
My heart out.
Mm-hmm.
Aren't you enjoying this? Because I am. Verse 20, he said, listen, so you have my permission. You want to do that during service? Amen. You know, it getting to you like, praise God. Yes, I'm in agreement with that. That's praise. Because you're not just hearing me, you're hearing God.
Amen.
And when you hear God, agree with God real fast. I agree with you, God. I agree with you. All right, verse 20. He said, they got up early in the morning and went to the desert of Tekoa. As they were leaving, Jehoshaphat stopped and said, listen to me, people of Judah and those living in Jerusalem. Trust the Lord your God and believe. Believe his prophets and you will succeed. Come on now. You got to believe the men of God that God gives you.
Mm-hmm.
If he gave you a man of God and you know he's a man of God, believe what he tells you. As long as it doesn't contradict and violate the word clearly.
Mm-hmm.
Verse 21. After he had advised the people, he appointed people to sing to the Lord and praise him for the beauty of his holiness.
Mm.
Now listen, this is not a proper battle technique. This is, in fact, let me read it here. As they went in front of the troop, they sang, thank the Lord because his mercy endures forever. This is not how you fight battle. You don't put praisers on the front line of a battle, and you're going to, you don't do that. That was not the proper battle plan.
Strategy.
Thank you. That was not the proper battle strategy going into battle. The reason why he put the praisers out front, it was an indication that when God said, you will not need to fight in this battle, that was his indication to God. I believe you, I'm going to put praisers out front. Because
mm-hmm.
typically what they did, they put the bow and arrows out front, or the spears out front
right. First.
And the praise you came after the battle.
Yeah, the praise came after. But he
and
turned,
warm, so.
He turned, come on, he already saw he had to put those things out front, man. Mm-hmm. Let's praise God now. Hallelujah. Look what he says here. All right. Verse 22. As they started to sing praises, the Lord set ambushes against the Ammonites, Moabites, and the people of Mount Seir who had come into Judah. They were defeated. Now, notice when God gets involved.
Mm-hmm.
Does he get involved simply because he said what he will do? Think about it. He didn't get involved just because he said, you don't have to fight this battle. God doesn't even get involved until they start praising.
Mm-hmm.
Then he do the same thing with Gideon. He didn't even get involved until Gideon start praising.
Mm-hmm.
See, just because God says something to you, Don't mean not gonna get involved until you believe what he said. Your praise is an indication you believe him. The walls of Jericho didn't come down until they believed God enough to shout loudly. And then God brought the wall down. So see, we think, well, God said he gonna bless me. He said he gonna bless me. You know what? Yeah, but if you don't believe him to where your lifestyle and your praise life is empowered by that, you might spend the rest of your life never seeing it happen. Come on. Thank you, Dee. There has to be an activation. And what activates every promise in your life that God has made you, what activates that is your obedience and praise. Without those two things, it's not going to work. You're not going to be moving forward. I don't care how fast you run on a treadmill. Guess what? You're still going nowhere. Isn't that true? You ain't going nowhere. I don't care. You can run 100 miles an hour, sweat flowing off your face and everything else, and you still haven't gone, you still in the same room.
Like, reminds me of the hamster.
Come on, the hamster on the wheel. The hamster on the wheel.
I never understood. Is that fun to him? Because he's just like,
he ain't going nowhere, but hey. But that's how a lot of people are. Where God is concerned. They think because they're on the hamster wheel of life running, that they're going somewhere. Not really. Not without obedience and praise. That hamster, with all that running that hamster is doing, guess what? He's still not moving forward.
He's doing his tiring himself out.
Get off. I hamster to run, then get off and drink some water. He get back on the little wheel, they start running again. You hit at nighttime, you hit a little wheel, you hear him drinking, and you hear the water go bloop, 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 bloop. And guess what? Guess what? When we got up in the morning, guess what that hamster was? Still in the cage, ain't going nowhere. With that much running, and he was out of the cage and did that kind of running, guess where he would have been? Probably somewhere else. But that's how a lot of Christians are. They spend their life running, drinking, running, drinking, running, drinking, and going nowhere. Because there's no obedience and there's no praise. They don't exalt what God has done in their life. They don't remind themselves of how far he's brought them. They don't remind themselves of the great things God has done. They don't testify to themselves about how faithful God has been to them over the years. They don't talk to themselves. But we're supposed to meditate on the things that God has done. Now, why did he tell them to write a book of remembrance? So that their children could remember that God has done some things for them. Amen. Even Gideon knew of the testimonies of what God had done. Though he was not seeing them, he knew they existed. And it created a longing in him to see the same thing. All right, let me keep going. Y'all good? Verse 23. Then the Ammonites and the Moabites attacked the people from Mount Seir and annihilated them. After they had finished off the people of Mount Seir, they helped destroy one another. The people of Judah went to the watchtower in the den and looked for the crowd. Corpses were lying on the ground. No one had escaped. Listen, notice this. God only got involved, even though he gave him this wonderful promise, he only got involved when they start praising. And that's what we miss. God makes us promises, but we never have a praise over what he promised us. And what I mean by praise, I'm not talking about just hooping and shouting, but I'm talking about obedience, because they had obedience. They did exactly what God told them to do, and in their obedience, they praised God. And that's what empowered God to move on their behalf, because that was an indication they believed what he said.
They didn't have to fight the battle. God.
Amen. So there are three, I'm going to give you three things. I'm going to rehearse these three things. Three things that will affect your praise life. Number one, we said in Gideon, what we learned from Gideon is a lack of confidence. But never be confident in your ability. Always be confident in the ability of God. On your behalf. Number two, what we learn from the walls of Jericho, what we learn from the walls of Jericho is there will be physical and spiritual barriers that we have to break through. Your physical barrier might be you might be ingrained in thinking that you're a black person or you're whatever, and you think that limits you. You may think because of your age, you may be limited. You may think because of your education, you may be limited. Now, that's true in the world, but not in God. David didn't have any education, but he became king.
Amen.
And the Bible says that God taught David how to be king. He taught David how to go in and out before the people. The greatest lessons you learn are from God. And the way God teaches it to you is a whole lot purer than the way the world teaches to you. Because the world will probably intermingle some other things in there that may not be really pure.
Mm-hmm.
And then we look at King Jehoshaphat, and this is another thing that will hinder our praise life. Seemingly overwhelming odds. When we look at things and we think the odds are stacked against us, we will believe that we're not able to do it. But if God be for you, he's more than the world against you. And with God, you and God are a majority. And always remember that. You and the Lord are the majority. Always. So just get in agreement. Obey him. Follow his instruction. And then praise him. Give him thanks. Rehearse in your life what he has done for you. And I think about so many things all the time about what he's done in my life and what he's brought me and how I got to this point. And you know, just even in the next chapter of my life, what is he doing and going to do? And I know I'm excited about it. Praise God. I really am. Because you know what? He does all things well. I don't have to know what it is. I just know it's going to be good. I don't have to understand. I don't have to figure it out. I just trust the Lord. It's going to be good. Praise God. And you can too. Amen. All right, so we're sharing with you moving forward with praise. Let your praise of exalting him be something that you do on a regular and consistent basis. Don't go a day without remembering what he has done for you and reminding him of what he has done for you. Because when you remind him, that's an indication, it shows you're an appreciative person for what he has done. Amen. Because nobody wants to bless somebody that's ungrateful. Mm-hmm. And that's true. We, you know, you want to bless somebody, don't ever even bother to say thank you. Mm-hmm. Or what you bless them with, they don't take care of it. Mm-hmm. Yeah, might as well really appreciate the blessing of the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. Mm-hmm. Praise God. Well, I pray that blessing, I pray that helps you.
Mm-hmm.
And again, we're talking about moving forward with praise. Amen. Hallelujah. Father God, we thank you for this word tonight, Lord, and we just pray that even as we travel home, we thank you for the blood of Jesus that covers us, and we thank you that each of us will arrive at our destination safely without incident. And I just pray, Father, even as we go through the rest of this week, that you would remind us by the Holy Spirit that there is something we need to be thanking you for, things we need to remember of what you have done and promises you've made us that you will surely fulfill. And so we thank you, Father God. We praise you. And we give you the glory.
Yes.
In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen.